First things first, rest in peace, sucker Phil. For real, you the only father that I ever knew. I get my bitch pregnant, I'ma be a better you. Prophecies that I made way back in the veil. For Phil, listen, even back when we was broke, my team ill. Martin Luther King would have been on Dreamville. Talk to her, nigga. One time for my LA sisters. One time for my LA hoes. Lame niggas can't tell the difference. One time for a nigga who knows.
Good afternoon, good evening. I just want to say that clap for God and I hear. Can it be better organized?
Asan Sana.
Another one for God. Thank you. Clap for yourselves.
Yes.
Well, before I start, let me say that I'm really sorry for keeping you waiting, but I'm glad that you have waited and you are patient up to this time. And I was trying to test whether you can persevere deliberately, because those who persevere are the ones who succeed. Those who are impatient do not complete their journey properly. I'd like first to say, you may have sat in this place and you don't know your neighbor. Look her or him in the face and say, peace be with you. And ask the name, know the name, please. Find out. You never know. This could be the beginning of very long things, long time things in the future. Even after some years, you say, you know where we met? Could be 10, 20, 40, 50 years, and you say, we met there. And it is not by accident that you are here. It is by God's grace that in the history of your life, you are here at this time, and you are discussing this particular subject, knowledge for life. As Mnyanguka has told you, first of all, you know they like calling people titles, patron, what, president, chairman. Those titles sometimes are changeables. There are two words, changeables and constants. I fear changeables. I like constants. Your father and your mother are constants. Your spouse, your boyfriend and your girlfriend are changeables. Therefore, of the titles that he was giving me, the one I like is founder, because Knowledge for Life initiative started in 2005, and it was a result of an association, of another very important association called the Gray-Haired and Bald-Headed Members Association. I repeat, the Gray-Haired and Bald-Headed Members Association. Why did I start that association? I observed that when we came from the bush, our main effort was uniting all Ugandans, and we were terribly discussing and opposing sectarianism. But slowly by slowly, after some years, we are now discussing, should we go back to multi-parties? And we finally voted for it. And I said, alas, here we are again, divided. So I looked for what association could unite everyone. And the best I could find was that, whether you like it or not, as long as you live and become old, you will either be bald-headed or gray-haired. I know at your age, your hair is black and you think it will stay like that. But it reaches a point when most of your parts which are haired start turning gray. So if you see some people shaving their beard clean, sometimes they just don't want to show their gray hair here. But that association was very interesting. What we did in that association was very simple. Very, very simple. We invited a few people, and we would invite one elder. And we don't warn him of the topic he's going to talk about. We say, we just want you to come and attend our meeting as our guest. And when he reaches there, we say, we want you to talk about your life, history. Do you need to prepare for that topic? If I asked any of you to give us a lecture about your life history, would you need to prepare? Now, so we would listen to these old people, and they tell us how they started, where they were born, how they grew up, those who went to school, how they went to school, where, until, and that was the most amazing lectures we have ever enjoyed. Out of the gray-haired and bald-haired members association, actually, slowly by slowly, we were being joined by young people. Young people started joining us. And they were getting more excited, hearing, you know, some of you think you are the only person who suffered, who went through these difficulties, who has, only to find that, by the way, these experiences are all common experiences. The more you hear from, the more you share with others. So out of this association, which we are meeting every week, we formed what we called tribes. We called them tribes. Now, this time, these tribes were not sectarian. We started with the nutrition tribe, because some of the lectures were talking about nutrition, and we found it so important. So we started a nutrition tribe, and actually, as a result, we started a nutrition college. Then we started an environment and tree planting tribe. Because people would tell us their histories and would tell us how important the environment is and how some of them who tried to plant trees, how it became very useful. And we started planting trees, and I am now a big tree grower. And with many other big members. Then we started the anti-corruption tribe. And we formed a group called Uganda Volunteers and Corruption Campaign Africa, VACOCA. Volunteers, and it is a big organization. Out of it, we found that the most important thing in life is knowledge sharing. And that's what resulted into the initiative of starting Knowledge for Life initiative. Why? All those elders who were giving us lectures, not all of them had gone through the academic education, and some were very prosperous. A good number were very rich around the town, were very important, but the majority of them, a good number of them, had never gone to university. So we identified that there was a huge gap in our education system where very important knowledge for life, which every citizen of the world need, was being left out. And the academic knowledge was actually very dangerous. Why? Because the higher you go, the less you understand. That might sound a bit ridiculous. When you start primary, actually before you go to school, the world is open to you to enjoy to the maximum. You run, you fall down, everything, before you understand, before there are restrictions that don't go here, you are just a free person, a young person. The moment they put you in class, in primary, then you are introduced to very limited subjects. Life is no longer as free. You are now must be told you must learn mathematics, you must learn English, you must learn history. Life is no longer as free. Go to secondary school. Secondary school, the subjects are numbered. The worst part starts when you go to HSC. You must choose either to do arts or sciences. And there it depends on how by some accident you pass some subjects. It has nothing to do with what you are interested in. It has nothing to do with really what you like most. It is what you have passed. Continue. When you reach there, of course, you are doing a few subjects. Not all the arts, not all the sciences. Then you go to university. There you are really more and more limited. If you are unfortunate to do 3-1-1, you are being more and more confined. And the worst part is PhD. Permanent head damage. Why? Because you go and specialize in a very limited area of that academic study. And I give a very, very good example. By the way, he's finishing this year. My famous friend who has been, for the last 5 years, been doing his PhD on the rare amino acids in the brain of a tick. He's not studying about the whole tick. You know what a tick is? A small insect which bites cows and animals. He's not studying about the whole tick. He's studying about the brain of a tick. He's not studying about the whole brain of a tick. He's studying about the amino acids in the brain of a tick. He's not studying all the amino acids in the brain of a tick. He's studying about the rare ones in the brain of a tick. And when he comes back, really, he will be knowing so much, but about so little. That's what happens. That's what happens to PhD. My daughter recently finished her PhD. Now, when she came from Australia, I asked her, she was doing a PhD in agriculture, in plant pathology. So I said, how many farms did you visit? She said, none. I said, what? She said, all the specimens were being brought to me in the lab. I said, what do you mean? She said, I spent all my 5 years in. Can you see the level of limitation? And now she comes back. We wanted to get her a job in the UPDF production unit. They say you are overqualified. They can't employ you. You're overqualified. Now things are becoming more limited. She was working in Kawanda before, when she was doing her master's. When she went back, they said, now the project is for the people of master's, the PhD, we don't have a project for them. She lost her job. She was trying to go to universities. The universities were full. Now up, well, she finally got some job in Nairobi. It has got to finish his back. She has more limitations for employment than many of you. With her PhD, permanent head damage, because she's categorized, she's boxed in one small specific area. However, I'm not saying that those are not useful people. Very useful. They are very useful. But in matters of education, we discovered that there is a lot of necessary knowledge which every citizen of the world need to know and understand for being a human being. How come that most of the PhD holders die poor? Have you not studied? How come that the richest people in the world are those who left university or never went there? Check the top 100 best richest men in the world. I think it's only 5 or 10% who are graduates. How come that for us, our generation, for you, you have been born in a very interesting generation of the NRM, that our generation of people, of parents who never went to school, are the ones who have the best homes, and they are the ones who have brought out a whole generation of a nation, and they never went to school at all? Like my parents, actually, it's only my mother who went up to P3, and she was taken to be a very important person. But most of our parents never stepped in a school. We found that there was a lot of knowledge that is vital and critical for every citizen to understand. When I entered here, I could see how limited you are from three things. One, the MC here, he started by giving us stories about the agenda, about what is going to happen, before we sing the national anthem. Have you not been watching how functions work? No, I want all of you to learn, because you're all going to be, you should all be able to be an MC at a function, at least that one. Really? You finish university and you cannot be an MC? So in the likely, in unlikely event, or the likely event that you are one, once the guest of honor arrives, there is no other talk, there is no other business, the first thing you sing there, the national anthems. And now, we don't sing only Ugandan anthem. It was a decision taken, we must sing two anthems. I was very keen and interested to hear, do these university students know our national anthems? Can I challenge you? How many of you know both anthems? Who can sing them? Put up your hands. Hara! Hey, testing. Testing. Those who think can sing the two anthems from one to the end, all the stanzas, put up your hands and straight put it up. Don't do like this. No. Okay. Check around. Look behind, friends. Look behind. How many are putting up? And then all of you who are not putting up your hands, say, shame upon us. Knowledge number one of a student in primary one should be to know the national anthem. I was in P2 when we got independence. But I can tell you that in P2, even before the day came, we were already singing the national anthem in primary two. University students, and you don't know the national anthem, and you think you are educated, what have you learned? The national anthem is a summary of all the most important things about our country. Oh, Uganda! That alone stops there. Many of you think about yourselves, Joy, Jody, John. You are not saying. The most important thing is Uganda. Oh, Uganda! May God uphold thee. We lay our future. The Makerere people say we build for the future. Here we are laying everything in the hands. We lay our future in thy hands. Now hear the words that follow. United. Did they say Baganda? Did they say Wanyankore? Did they say Karamajongs? They say what? United. Next is free. Have you ever analyzed that anthem? For what? For liberty. For who? Together. We shall do what? Always, not just once in a while, but always stand. Can we say it? That verse stands alone, together in words. Together. Oh, Uganda.
Oh, Uganda.
May God uphold thee.
May God uphold thee.
We lay our future in thy hands. United, free, for liberty, together, we shall always. Who can demonstrate stanza two? Who can dramatize it here? Oh, Uganda, the land of freedom. After me, oh Uganda,
oh Uganda,
the land of freedom,
the land of freedom.
Our love,
our
labor,
we give.
You know, I don't know who sang this song in primary. Who sang it, the national anthem? In your primary school, who sang it? Who were able to sing your national anthem in the primary school? Which school did you go to? Huh? Oh. Those who know, let two of them come here. Those who know the anthem. Come here. Who can sing it? Who are confident? Who can sing the national anthem? Because if you don't understand the national anthem, really, what knowledge do you have? Yes? Clap for them, first of all, for having that confidence. The others were not confident, although they put up their hands. You want to sing us the second stanza? But you, so that you can hear her voice, you know? Yeah, a mic, okay? And you can join her, but let her lead us. The second stanza, the land of freedom.
For Uganda, the land of freedom, our love and labor we give. And with neighbors all at our country's call in peace, friendship, we live.
Clap for her. What is your name?
Marina Tukunda from Chambogo University.
Marina Tukunda, Chambogo University. The last stanza. Oh, Uganda, the land that feeds us.
Oh, Uganda,
the land that feeds us. By sun and fertile soils grow. For our own dear land, we shall always stand in the power of Africa's ground.
Clap for him. Your name and where you come from?
I'm called Asimwe George. I come from at Chambogo University.
Yes. Okay. Thank you very much. Now, I am very serious on this matter. Next time, tell your fellow university students, if you don't learn your national anthem, we have told all the recruiting organizations that the first question in the interviews for any job is to ask those people to sing the national anthem. Nobody should get a job in Uganda if he cannot sing the national anthem. Otherwise, what basis are you going to have? This doesn't need to go to Changwans, this one. Any university which passes out university students who can't sing the national anthem should feel ashamed. I'm going to write to all the vice chancellors that we shall judge universities from how they prepare their students. The East African anthem. I know you don't know Swahili. Very unfortunate. But fortunately, we've recently passed in cabinet that it must be mandatory. Swahili should be taught everywhere and is another national language. For unity, for uniting the whole of East Africa, it's one of the most widely spoken languages of the world. And therefore, that was just about the national anthem. Now, we had our prayer here. The one who was selected to pray, he spoke in a language that most of us don't understand. And he's entitled because that is his religion. But I thought, if you have observed what we do at functions these days, you should copy from the Mufti. The Mufti Mubaji. He now comes, he can speak, he can pray in Arabic, but afterwards he prays in English so that we all understand his prayer. So when you go to a function, don't go there and say things people don't understand. All this is knowledge you'll not find in a textbook. All we have been discussing, will you find it in any textbook? No. Basic knowledge for life. Basics, basics, basics. You people, you are supposed to be learning from your parents, but alas, you start kindergarten, you're in a boarding school. Primary, in a boarding school. Secondary, in a boarding school. And university in a hostel. My God, there is no father, there is no mother. The people who actually create what is not there are artists who are like God. There are two categories of people in the world. Category number one are those who create what is not there. The artists, the designers, the innovators, the creators, those create what is not there, like God. The second category, who are the majority? Those, the other first category, number one, are very few. The majority, category number two, are those who just follow what category number one has created. They just follow what has been created for them. They repeat in factories, they manufacture in many, they sell, but they are creating what's... That's why you have them tied. How can free people be tied? A hanging thing. Men already have enough hanging things, but they have something hanging on their neck. What function does it play? But because somebody designed the tie a century ago, these followers are just having a rope around their neck. For what purpose? What purpose does it serve if it is not just being a follower? Be careful of those hanging things. So, the subject that we found was very important. Subject number one on our curriculum, which we would like everyone to study and understand, is a result of the three words, and that is knowledge sharing. Subject number one, we write it down. On our knowledge for life curriculum, I mean syllabus, subject number one is knowledge sharing. Human beings are proud that we are the ones who know how to communicate, because we can only talk to ourselves. But trees communicate. Birds communicate. Insects communicate. We only don't know their language, they don't know our language. Even cattle communicate. Goats, dogs, birds. If you lived with nature like some of us have, you would hear them communicating and singing together and in tune. Have you never heard these cockroaches in the morning or at night? They have fantastic music. Cockroaches, yes! You are not close to nature. You live in the skyscrapers. Insects communicate. Actually, they are cleverer than you. I can give you evidence. When they bombed Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the Americans, they bombed Japan with the first atomic bombs on the ground, which destroyed everything else living was destroyed, except the cockroach. The cockroach survived. And you think you are very important. And you think you are very clever. You can't survive the nuclear bomb, even a slight one. But the cockroach needs, you need to multiply it 10 times heavier to kill a cockroach. We have tried to spray them with doom. But have you seen cockroaches disappear? They are still very much. So human beings have been prouding themselves of sharing, of communicating. Good. But the subject, how do you share what you have? Anything you have, sharing, knowledge, sharing. If you have any knowledge, life, civilization, progress, development, understanding is a result of sharing. You people who go to universities and learn those specialized small knowledge, if you don't share it, we bury a library every time we bury a person. I am trying to release a part of what I have in my library so that I can share it with you. You go and keep it under the bushel. The Bible is very clear about it. How many of you have been going back to your villages to take the knowledge you have got from university if it is useful. You leave university and you have no job, and those who have never gone to school have permanent jobs in the village there, permanently, and they are living happily. You are finishing your shoe with walking Kampala. If you had knowledge from the university, how come that those found jobs and they are looking after their families and you are now looking for a job? Because you are not sharing your knowledge. Still at the university, if you started right now where you are, this, you know, some of us don't sing for the sake of singing. Me, I don't sing for money. I sing for message. Sample my song, Ainunu. Ainunu, you know what Ainunu means? Ainunu means something beautiful, something nice, something sweet, something romantic, something... I wish I could see, continually see our beautiful country, our country, Uganda, of milk and honey, full of fresh water, fresh air, fauna and flora, full of sunshine. The part of Africa. Amen. That you understand it. But alas, they don't even tweet it on radio, they don't sing it, they don't like it. Because they don't love Uganda.
I can be the promoter.
You find them singing the wrong things. Things which are threatening. Bigwao, pigenda kugwao. Who says? Bizemu. So, knowledge sharing. Knowledge sharing. Knowledge sharing. Is so important that you should always have, pass it on, pass that message of how beautiful, share the country Uganda, how wonderful it is, share it with the others, learn. When I sing Chino Chechisera, we were very serious. There is no time for sharing knowledge, it's now. Every time is a good time for. Actually, what is lacking is not time. Write that down. What is normally missing is focus. It's not time. All of us have 24 hours a day. All of us, God is so fair. Because we are all rotating at the same speed. If you don't know at first how fast the earth rotates, it is 110,000 kilometers per hour. If you have ever driven a vehicle at 110 kilometers, multiply by 1,000, and you know the speed at which the earth is moving. And it gives us 24 hours a day for it to rotate. We all have equal time, but we don't have equal focus. So, this is the time. There's no time for you to say, when I finish university is when I will start thinking about my life, is when I will start thinking about a job. Now! Start now. It's when I will start thinking about a home. No. Everything must be started now. Chino chechi se. Mwetu ino kukora. Muvi se rabio maso. We enjoy this generation. You don't know how much we love you. That's topic number one, sharing. Share it now. Don't delay. Share with your friend. You stay in a room with somebody. All you are talking about are your problems. Read a book. Share it with a friend. That knowledge you have got, let him share or her. You spend more time of saying, I love you. No, tell him some knowledge. Let me tell you now tactics. If you want a girl to love you, when you meet her, power knowledge with her, to her. Let her see that you actually knowledge. The same vice versa. Men want ladies who are knowledgeable, who have something you have read, something you have heard the story in his ear. It will be very romantic. Don't just come and say, oh, send money, what? No. Don't go things. Look for high noon things. Share the positive in life. Share that subject I'm dwelling on, it's topic number one, because life has two sides. Everything is a dual, and it's necessary, negative and positive. Whenever we are attending weddings, I tell the partners, and since you are all preparing or you are already young married, if your spouse or your friend, if you want to look at your spouse and you look for the negative side, every person has a negative side. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We are all sinners. Tell your friend that we are all sinners. Tell her or him that you are a sinner. Dangerous one. Now, don't look for his or her sins. Please, don't look for the bad side. Look for the good, positive side. And you will find a lot of bad side if you look for it. You will find a lot of good side if you look for it. Depending on how you are sharing. So that is just to move fast forward. Knowledge sharing is subject number one. Subject number two, which is crucial for your life, is security. Write it down. After knowledge sharing, topic number two is security. You people think security is for the armed forces, security is for those who are supposed to be in those departments. Every individual has a responsibility, and even the Constitution says it, but apart from the Constitution, every living thing must take care of its own security. Let me take it, my ancestors. How many of you would like to, which of the two are you choosing? The first or the second? How many of you are choosing the second? It is difficult. And don't go thinking it is everything is easy, but don't go for easy things, please. Easy things, easy come, easy go. So that philosophy of how you create wealth is a discussion you should start now. Don't think because you have not got money in your pocket, you will be able to be very rich when you finish university. Start from now. Let me share with you. Me, I lost my father the day I got my acceptance form to Makerere. That same day. My mother had died a few years back. After receiving my acceptance, I was very happy. I was teaching in a class. Only 2 hours after, another letter comes that your father has died. That started my maturity. I had to come from Masaka to come to Kampala to get a train to take me to Kabogore, Kiruhura. It was a long journey, but I went saying, I will manage. I will manage. And after the burial, the relatives are saying, now, how do you have to go to university? You want to manage. I said, I will manage. I became very rich at university, very rich, because of that challenge. You always see me with a camera. I just bought a simple Olympus camera, small, like Olympus pen, in the first term of the first year. And at exactly 5 after lectures, I would go to halls and take those who had girlfriends and boyfriends who were enjoying it and basking in it. And they pay, of course. I go quickly, develop, tomorrow I bring the photographs. Now they want to take in another posture. For me, that was more money. And I would encourage them, no, you didn't sit very well. Put the hand on her. Because the more pictures they took, the more money I was. I became very rich. I became the campus photographer. I ended up getting my own dark room because one of the laborers was delaying me. I had money to get to Kampala. Me, I would come with a special hire from campus to buy my films and go back. Special hire. The one who was an orphan. By the time I left university, I had a shop at home. And I want to tell you, I'm telling you this to share with you. It is the attitude you have towards life. that will make you wealthy. Your attitude will determine your attitude. But if you start off with an attitude that, me, I am an orphan, me, I am poor, I come from a poor home, I have no money, I may not do like the other fellow, I am the condemned, you condemn yourself. God created all of us with opportunities that are equal. Same 24 hours, provides the whole sun to us free, provides the free air to free us. It is how you plan for your wealth. The second subject after wealth, subject number 6, is science and technology. I have told you the curriculum, the syllabus or the education system breaks us down and wants to say, these are artists, these are scientists. Every living person must be conscious of science. And science does not mean that you have to go into a class to pass the chemistry class. No. But learn how technology works. Whether it is a hoe, whether it is a panga, whether it is a rake, whether it is a mobile phone, please go with the times, know the change. They have effect on your life. Be conscious of them. Whether you are studying history, you will have to learn how to use a computer, because it is the modern way of communicating, of sharing, of writing. Don't just say because for you are an artist, you don't learn what is going on, you are not conscious of the changes of the technology, because technology is actually a result of artistic design. It's a result of design, and I'm coming to that next. So be conscious of science, the available science of the time. Use the science, learn to use it, and share it, and talk about it. We now have microphones. We don't have to shout or use the other ones. You have seen, you remember the other ones where they would, which you would be holding. It's now very easy. I now can communicate with anybody, anywhere, on WhatsApp, when we are looking at each other and romancing. Yeah, it's now easy. Now, is that science? Is that for artists or scientists? An artist might use that better than a scientist. Actually, a scientist doesn't have much time to enjoy themselves. They are suffering in labs and thinking about curricula and all that. So, these things, you must be conscious how to medicine changes. You find many people, they are still now treating people, some people with chloroquine. I did a paper about malaria at Chimaka, at the Senior Command and Staff College. And I know about malaria more than any of the doctors. Many of them. And some of them studied about malaria when 20 years ago, when there was quinine. And they believe in it so much that they still treat people with quinine when the whole system has changed. Just to show you an example. For science and technology, you all have to learn. These days, the best thing that has happened to the world, which you should take advantage of, is Mr. Google. Where is my wife? You can access any knowledge. Let me tell you, anything you talk about, I Google, I research, and we can add you. On any subject, you don't take advantage of that. For you, you think you're about the max, or you must pass for the exam. Knowledge is available. What excuse do you have? Just to give an example, for you who are students, science has made it easy for you to access knowledge. But if you don't want, it is up to you. Another subject. This is number 7. Art, design, and innovation. I told you everything depends on its design. Things are things as they are. But different progress, development, advancement of civilization and of society depends on the innovators and the creators and the original people. There's another book I was reading called The New Mind Era by David Cotton. The New Mind Era now was saying that actually people who have been studying management, masters of business administration in Harvard University, 50% are going back to study masters of fine art. Why? Because in the present modern competitive world, if you are to compete, you must be innovative, you must be creative, you must be original to have an edge over others. You who don't think, who are not studying art, who were unfortunate that even in your primary school you will not have a chance to play in the sand, you are not given clay to play with, your mind is very, very, very limited to textbook. Textbooks are too late. Let me tell you something about textbooks. By the time a textbook comes out to be put on the syllabus, it is behind by 10 years. It is talking of 10 years, that's how things were being done. All these textbooks are history books. You can get a formula out of it, but I can tell you most of the textbooks are talking of the situation that was happening at the time. In the present world, you need to be very creative, you need to be very innovative, you need to be original for you to compete. This is a subject you are not going to be taught if you are in the science lab. This is not a subject you are going to be taught when you are in a history club or class. Even talking philosophy will not teach you that you need to be innovative, you need to be creative. They will teach you philosophy of the books written by a century ago. Important books to study, very good. But you should be conscious of the changing creativity and how it is influencing society. This subject is very, very important. I'm just giving headlines, but when you go to the detailed study, and I would like to encourage you that you really get involved in this foundation course, it will help your future. One sentence can change the rest of your life. One sentence can change the rest of your life. How did I become an artist? I grew up wanting to be a lawyer. I was fortunate, I had two very famous lawyers on my father's side, Grace Vienjira, my cousin, and on my mother's side, John Wycliffe Kazora, my cousin, on my mother's side. Both were famous lawyers. So I grew up wanting to be a liar. I call them liars. Because every case has two lawyers on each side. One of the two must be telling a lie. So I wanted to be a liar. Because those were the famous ones. But one day, we were in a class, and our art teacher, well, first of all, I ended up doing art because our art teacher, one of our art teachers used to play guitar in the art room. And I liked music, so I like to attend. I used to do art while I'm listening to his guitar. And eventually he formed us into a band called the Scorpions. And I liked him I liked him as a person and his music. So I ended up doing his, now, he's the one who advised me that you seem to have a talent. So go and do fine art as a fourth principle at HSC. And at the time, there were limited schools which were offering fine art as a fourth principle. And that's how I ended up from Barra High School to St. Henry's College, Kitovu. It was the most famous school for art. So as I was doing my fourth principle in a class, my art teacher, Francis Musango Gwantamu, was teaching us. He was a very jolly fellow. He died. He said, you know, when you are doing art, you don't have to look for a job. I said, what? We were in class, I kept on working. Now on a Saturday, I go and visit him at his home. I find him, in fact, in his compound painting. So he gives me a stool, I sit on his side, and we talk. And I said, sir, what has brought me is the statement you made in class. He laughed. He said, ah, he used to have a hearty laugh. He said, what crime did I commit in class? I said, sir, you said that when you are an artist, you don't have to look for a job. What did you mean? He said, don't you see? In actual fact, me, I don't get money from teaching. I get very little money. Much of my money I get from my paintings. And I sell all over the world. I have no limitation. I sell to US. I say, hey, you will not have to look for a job. That's how I ended up an artist. That statement. And I have never applied for a job. They actually requested me to be employed. One sentence, I'm sharing this with, if you listen to something which sparks your creativity, which provokes your idea, don't sleep on it. Pursue it. And look for where you are creative, where you are original, whether you are creating something new, where you are able to design. You don't need to do many things. I did not do fashion design at the School of Fine Art, but I was introduced to creativity. So I can design anything. This money you have, I'm the one who designed it, the money you are carrying in your pocket.
Sana.
We found that the Bank of Uganda was always hiring people abroad, and they would just do paste, copy and paste. And they were still putting cotton and coffee on our money. So we asked the bank, we have a group of artists, we have our company, can't we help? And they just went to test us. So we did a thorough research, and as a matter of fact, the money you have did not only become good, but it won the International Bank Notes Society for 2 years, the world. This 50 note, one, twice. Because we put in our mind, we put in our head. Just because of innovation, just the idea, you think, you create, you don't. When you think, we say in battle, in fighting, that the battle changes after the first bullet. After you have fired the first bullet, the situation changes. It depends on the creativity of the commander to assess the situation, to appreciate the way things are moving, and be innovative on how you deploy. Even in how you organize your people, how you share with them, depends on your creativity, depends on your understanding, depends on your innovativeness. It doesn't have to be an art painting. No. I'm not an architect, but I have now recently designed a no-corner house. My house has no corner because I don't believe in corners. Corners are a result of conflict. One side and another side meeting at a terrible corner, and it has it has another reason, because it came when our house was struck by lightning. All our four corners of our house cracked. And I cannot build a new house with such a weakness, which could crack. So I've designed a no-corner house, three-storied, my own design with my stick on the sand, like this. You have no limit if you are serious about innovation, if you are serious about creativity. Your mind is fertile enough to look at human heads like this one and see a nice painting out of them. You look funny, you all look rounded heads. Have you seen soldiers when they are doing kiapo, or when they have removed their caps in a parade? They look like pumpkins. And it is by nature as a design. The other day I presented a talk on the round circular cycle of life. How come things are round? Our heads are round, the eggs are round, the moon is round, the sun is round, the earth is round, the hills are round, the bushes are round, the anthills are round. How come? It's because of that speed, the circular side of life. How many of you have done karate and kung fu? The whole science is about roundness. Everything they say is, everything must be within a circular system, defense and everything. How come that this thing is round? Anyway, I am provoking your mind. Think deeper, create, think, analyze systematically, question. That's when you will be able to live a better life. After design, science and innovation, the other subject which is very, very important is talent identification. That's number 8, talent identification. Every living thing is unique. Every living thing is unique deliberately. That's why each living thing has its own DNA. Every living thing is unique, so that it performs a unique function. Accordingly, every living thing has talent which is different from others. You can't be the same talent like me. So, this business of teaching everybody same subject, are we the same? It's not correct. There are many countries which are developed. They identify a good footballer, a good musician, a good artist at another age. For us, everyone must go to university. Everyone must study the same subject. Are we machines? In a factory is where you put on a chain and you are producing. No, you are unique. Identify the talent that there is around you. See what interests you more. Don't study for getting a certificate. What is a certificate? It has been hanging in my house. I don't touch it. It is my head which works, not the paper. You are dying to get papers. But many of those who leave university to do passion things which they are passionate about end up being very successful. So identify your talent. Identify your children's talent when you get them. Encourage them to pursue them. Don't force them. There was a case in Makerere where the parents forced a person to study medicine. And he studied because the parents were very consistent. He studied his medicine. He finished. He went and did the internship. He finished. After those years, 5+ internship, he got all the certificates. He took them and gave them to his father. He said, I have finished your degree. I request that you allow me to do my own degree. His father looked at him and said, what are you saying? He said, I have finished yours. Now I'm going to do mine. And he went and did law. He's around, actually. He's a known person. And he did his law. He's a lawyer. He's never practiced medicine. Instead, in spite of having studied medicine. That means they never identified his talent, where his talent or his passion was. They were forcing him from their own demands. He was clever, he passed all the subjects well. So, talent identification is important. Then, the ninth is moral values. Write it down. Moral values is a subject that must be discussed very seriously. Mahatma Gandhi, when he grew old, Mahatma Gandhi was the founder of, is the father of India. Mahatma Gandhi, when he grew old, the Indians wanted to grab as much knowledge from him as possible, like I'm trying to share with you. So they came to ask him questions, and they asked him one of the questions, he said, Muzei, what would be the most important 3 things a government should do for its people? He said, number 1, education. Number 2, education. Number 3, education. They were not satisfied. Then they said, Muzei, what are the 3 most important subjects in education? He pondered a little bit longer, according to the story. And then he told them that number one, moral values. Number two, moral values. Number three, moral. Tell your friend that moral. Here we are referring, moral values is referring to the good side of society. How to live in a society as a good person. How you conduct yourself so that you don't become a chfire, a fuya hagaze, chafada, gone case. You are not in that direction. You are not killing yourself. You are following, you have value. First of all, you remember we're talking about value. Now this time, because a thief could have thieving values, a killer might have killing. He has very tactics and he's a master in killing people. Those are not, that's some value. There is some value in his capacity to kill somebody. Like, I don't know, you know the case with the man who is in prison, who has even wanted to kill a judge. He's terrible machinery. He has terrible capacity to kill with his body. It's a value to some extent, but you need moral values. That subject, you know how our religious people have spent all their lives. The ones who have actually, the ones who do more security work are not the policemen on the road, bro. The ones who do more work for security are the religious people who strengthen the police of the mind. Are you with me? You need strengthening the police of the mind, which tells you even when you are alone that don't sign that document for a bribe. When you are the two of you or you are alone with a guy, that guy, you know, whoever, who is going to do terrible things to you, that's police of the mind which says, hey, no, it's not the right time. That value, that moral value, that police of the mind, which tells you, don't do this, it will be shameful for your community. Don't do this, it will be shame your family. Don't do this, it is wrong. That moral value, that value of the police of the strength of your mind, which stops you from doing the wrong thing, is needed to be discussed, programmed, taught, strengthened, consolidated, and continuously revived. Moral values. Finally, the 10th subject is goal setting. Setting your goals, goal setting, implementation, monitoring, and evaluation. Every person, and I want to end by giving you 5 questions for the rest of your life. Every person should have a goal. Why are you, that's question number one. The 5 questions, question number one of your life to help you set your goals is, why are you doing what you are doing? That's question number one. Why are you doing what you are doing? At any time in your life, why are you here? Why am I saying this? I have a purpose. There must be a reason. So you ask yourself, why are you doing what you are doing? For you to set your goals, then you need to know, number two, question number two, where have you come from? Because there is another statement which says, we are what we know. Write that down. We are what we know. We become what we see, what we hear, what we experience or go through, but most importantly, what we do about it. We are what we know. We become what we see, what we hear, what we experience or what we go through, but most importantly, what you do about it. You have been here. I am sure you are willing to leave this place not the same way you came because of what you have had.
Asante sana.
Because of what you have had, you will not go the same person again after here. So you will become what you have been with addition with what you have got from here. You have been in churches, you have been in mosques, you have been in classes, people have been talking to you, but what has been happening, the most important part, is not that what you have heard, or what you have seen, or what you have experienced. The most important part is, what have you done about it? When that preacher preached to you, what did you do about it? When that experience you went through, which was dangerous, which you almost killed you, what did you do about it? So, once you know where you have come from, everyone has a history of his or her own. You need to analyze your situation every day. If I had time, I would tell you, that's why we are doing in the gray hair and bald headed. Where have you come from? In fact, one of our televisions have a program called Lebe Indigire, TV West. Huh? It is called what? Nehinda. Uh-huh. Now, that's, they have a program, say, Lebe Indigire. Where, see where I've come from. I would like each of you to go and write systematically the points. Why, the when, the who, the where, the what. Those are five. And the husband is the how. The final question is, how do you want to go there? That is the most important. How do you want to go there? How will you go there? You have already set your goals. You have looked where you have come from. You know what, why you are doing what you are doing. You are studying mathematics. You are studying biology. You are very good at fine art. You are very good as an architect. Yes, that's where you are now in the third year, or you are doing your final exams. That's where you are. Where you want to go, you want to become a great architect. You want to become a great doctor. You want to be a good politician. That is your goal. The challenge now is, how will you achieve that? So, these come from goal setting. Under goal setting, you should have what is now called a work plan. You should work out a roadmap. You should work out a, you see, for us, we called our struggle a protracted people's war. The strategy we took for our war was a protracted people's war. Protracted because the protractor has many factions, so it had many stages. And we are conscious, we know that the protracted people's war is a strategy, start as a guerrilla warfare, you go to mobile warfare, then you go to conventional warfare. And each stage is as important in that development. Start small, develop into mobile units or stronger units, and go where you can now have a front line, which is called conventional warfare. All that was planned from A, how do you move from A to Z, which is called strategy. But in between, there is what is called tactics. If I want to go to Entebbe, I can say I'll go by road as a strategy. But going by road means tactfully, from here I may walk to the stage where I get a border. From a border, it will take me to the bus park. From the bus park, I get a taxi. It puts me to a stage, and then I walk off home. Now, this in between, A to B, B to C, is tactics. But the strategy is going by road, as opposed to flying by air, or as deciding to walk on foot up to Entebbe, which is very possible, and very easy, and very healthy. Last weekend, I met a lady who walked Namugongo from my village. I couldn't believe that she could do it. But she was so revived. I said, what happened? She said, I was in my house and I saw on television old women coming from West Nile. And I said, if those can walk, I can also go. And I joined. And I walked, and I was able to come back. And by the time I reached, I was healthier. And I was more focused. And I was able to see Uganda. I had never known how Uganda looks like. The rest of the parts, he has always been in our village. She has always been there. She was now bright. She was, and then she said, I now improved my spiritual. I'm more spiritually filled. I am feeling more strengthened body-wise. And I now know about Uganda. She was in high morale. Because she chose her strategy. And went and came back. And used the strategy of walking to Namugongo. As opposed to you who are always moving in cars and sitting all the day, and you think it is very important to be in all the time sitting, that it is modern and very that the rich people do. It has an heresy. It's a killer. So everything you do, why are you doing it? Where have you come from? Where are you now? Where do you want to go? And how shall you go there? Those are the five important questions for your life as a way of finalizing to finish the goal setting, which is number 10. And I am happy to say and to thank Munyangoga, Mpigie Makofi, clap for him. Because when I started with the universities, me, I work with volunteers. By the way, not a single shilling has been put in this project of our initiative. Not a single shilling from government. Much before I became minister, I told you 2005. Yes, I was a member of parliament, but it was out of volunteerism. He volunteered to help me coordinate Makerere University then. And slowly by slowly, we've been having, since 2013, we've been having annual dialogues from the different universities, and we've moved to the different universities. We have discussed with many vice chancellors, and I'm glad to report that now at least three universities have agreed to introduce these Knowledge for Life subjects as foundation courses. So I would like to thank the coordination committee. It is a voluntary group. It was not through elections, because you know, you student life, I always see you. The youth is a transitory stage. It's not a permanent stage. Can I tell you something? We who are proud of being youths, just a few years to come, you'll no longer be. If you think the other people are not very important, soon you'll be out of it. So prepare for the future now while you are the youth. Work for the good of the future. I feel so happy and so proud. Actually, I want to share with you, young people. For us, we were willing to die for you. We were willing to die because we wanted a better generation. We were willing to die that our children, you, and now our grandchildren, by the way, congratulations. This morning I got a 14th grandchild. They are now calling me, I think they want me to go and see her. And I want to share with you, life at our time was not as wonderful as you people in this fantastic environment. And we had three prayers at a personal level. I always share this. At a personal level, there was, of course, threat of death and danger in the bush. But the question was, you would ask God, the prayer was, God, even if I die, and we're willing to die, that was our choice. Even if I die, at least, God, I pray that let me not die in vain, let our Let our war succeed. Let our cause win at a personal level. The second question was, prayer was God. You know, selfish. You are all, everyone is selfish. You say, God, I wish I could be among those lucky ones to see that victory day. As you know, some of our comrades died before we captured power. So they were not as lucky as we were. So that was another lack. Fulfilled prayer. Then the third one, which is relevant to you, was God. I pray that you could allow me to live, have a family, have children, and see them grow in a happier environment than we have had. So seeing you here, when you hear the president saying Wazukuru, you know he is genuine about it because his Wazukuru is as old as you. He's 10 years older than me. He taught me in P7. That's when we first met. He was my teacher in primary school. Yes. I met him one night. He had come to sleep at a friend's place where I had slept. And I can tell you something which is up to now amazes me. When we milked our cows at night and finished, we went to this man's place, home, where we were sleeping, and he started teaching this man what he's teaching today, family income, in 1967. He was telling this man, get one ndunde of bananas, get one ndunde of cassava, get one ndunde. That's when I first heard about ndunde. You know, ndunde is a quarter an acre. And he was telling him, fence your land with you, you have some trees, ngando. I listened. That was the first lecture of President Museveni to me outside the classroom in P7 of knowledge for life, which up to now he's still teaching. Family what? He was not yet a minister. He was not yet he was a student, a teacher. He had finished senior six. But was teaching this man, this old man, this he was actually not very old, knowledge for life and family income. I would like to request as I finish that what we have shared here, subject number one was what? Knowledge sharing. The lucky you, I have a song for your generation. We are the lucky ones who are here. We are the lucky ones who are here. We are the lucky ones. We are the lucky ones. We are the lucky ones who are here. Can you repeat that chorus? We are the lucky ones who are here. We are the lucky ones who are here. We are the lucky ones. We are the lucky ones. We are the lucky ones who are here. I want to end by saying, young people, this business of saying future leaders, forget, you are the current leaders. A leader is different from somebody. A leader is he who shows the others hope. A leader is he who shows others what? Who gives others hope. And I want to share with you, you be leaders. Go and share with your friends and tell them that Uganda has never had a good, young, educated generation like the present generation of NRM. The 34-year-olds, how many of you are 34 years and above? They're also above 34 years. One, two, three. Those who are below 34 years, put up your hands. When I say the NRM generation, I'm not talking about the party. I'm talking about the generation. Those who have been born who have grown, who have become educated, who have matured at this time in a much better environment than our first 24 years of independence. We have recently celebrated 57 years. Can you imagine what happened? That in 24 years, we had 9 presidents. Have you thought about it? In the first 24 years, we had how many presidents? What a country. Others had had just one. We had 9 presidents. So when we are sharing some of these things, some of you can't even conceptualize it. What chaos was here in this country? Turmoil after turmoil. And they were not being changed through elections. No, it was Kavuyu. So we are very happy that your generation now, this is your time. This is your time. Start as leaders. And the number one subject is share knowledge. Share. So, we volunteer. How many? Let me now hear the universities which are here. Come and read them for me as you are reading. Makerere University, those who are here. Pigia Wakofi, clap for them. That is not organized. I forgot to tell you one statement which you should write. The future belongs to the organized. The future belongs. Live here, you Makerere group, go and organize to share knowledge. Chambogo University? Well, yes, quite a number. Hapigia Makofi, give clap for them. Thank you very much. Read the list. Read the list. Yeah, you can use that. The other university?
IU Kampala campus.
IU Kampala campus. Oh, thank you very much. We give him a coffee.
Shall I read all of them?
Yeah, read one by one.
Ankole Western University.
Ankole Western University, who are here? Oh, they are where?
No one. Bishop Stuart University.
Barara?
Uganda Royal University.
Yes, Bugema Kofi.
Bugema University.
Yes, Bugema Kofi.
Bugema University Kampala.
The Kampala campus.
City Polytechnic Kampala. Guru University.
Yes, Guru University. How many are here?
None. They came on Wednesday and went.
Ibanda University. None.
Islamic University in Uganda, Kampala.
University of Kampala. Yes, they're here. Clap for them.
We have someone who traveled from Islamic University in Mbare on Tuesday and has been here.
Oh, who is that one? Stand up. Perseverance, patience. Clap for him. Very good.
Kabale University.
Not around.
Islamic University in Uganda, we have. Kampala International University.
Kampala International, yes, clap for them. Oh. Very good.
Is there anyone from Western Campus? Shaka. Then Mutesa Royal University.
Mutesa Royal University, clap for them. Yes.
Chambogo has already been said.
Road Development Center. Have some liars here.
Then Makerere University Business School Nakawa.
Business School, yes, clap for them.
The branch of Mbarara, they are not here. Then Mbarara University of Science and Technology.
Must.
We have someone who traveled
yes,
to Mbarara.
Thank you very much. Clap for him.
Marako Paramedical School.
The Paramedical School.
They're not around.
Mountains
of the Moon University.
Fort Portal. Not here.
Ndeje University Kampala.
Ndeje University. Yes, clap for them.
Ndeje University Main is not here. Timu University Mbeja University main, someone, okay.
Oh, Mbeja University main, are also here? Yes, clap for him.
Kim University Kampala.
Kim University Kampala?
Not around. St. Joseph's University in Mbarara, formerly Uganda Matters University.
Uganda Matters University in Mbarara? Not around. Not here.
Uganda Christian University, Kampala.
UCU, Kampala campus. Yes, they are there.
UCU Mukono.
UCU Mukono. They didn't come? Mm-hmm. They were around? Uh-huh.
Uganda Matters University, Nkozi.
Nkozi University? No one? Uh-huh.
Uganda Pentecostal University, Kampala.
Uganda Pentecostal University, Kampala. Yeah. Yes, clap for them.
Is there anyone from Uganda Pentecostal, Maine?
Yes, from Maine. Uh-huh. Clap.
Then YMCA Wandega, anyone?
YMCA?
No one. Mm-hmm. Those are the 33.
Well, you see, really, as I have said, every year we've had dialogues, and we've been having them at universities, but because the universities have become very many, we thought that instead of going to one university and then other universities don't share, we'd rather have representatives from those universities who can make it. We don't need many people. Let me tell you, it is not about big numbers. It is about the value. If you live here with some value, just go and share it. And I want to share with you the revolutionaries of the world, those who have changed society, are not necessarily those who fought the greatest wars, but those who taught. Jesus just taught for only 3 years. Only three. Like you have spent at university. 3 years. And on foot, not in a vehicle. He had to hire a donkey for his triumphal entry. So, share. That's the power of sharing. That's the power of teaching. That's the power of missionary work. You don't have to pay money. It's not about money. Use what you have, and you have everything you need. You have your head, you have your body, you have your foundation, and we want to thank those who are already leaders. The guild presidents who are here, please stand up and recognize you and give you another clap. The guild, these who are already enjoying the clap for them. We congratulate you and really want to thank you. Take charge of this country, young people. But don't take charge of it by wanting to spoil things. You find people selling their groundnuts on the street and you power them that you are demonstrating. Is that building your generation? Sit, talk, plan. When you hear, they fought 5 years in the bush. Every day was not about firing bullets. What was happening every day was that we would sit from morning to evening, from evening to the midnight, every day for 5 years. Fighting would be once in a while. After we have wrecked and we have found this is a soft target, this is what. But once that would be once in a while. Not every day, but every day we were sitting down and discussing those five questions. Why were we in the bush? Where had we come from? Where had Uganda come from? Where had it reached at each stage? Where would we want it to go? And how should we take it there? From now, discuss that subject about Uganda. You are Uganda, not mine. I can tell you, for us, we've done our part. We are proud and happy to have made whatever little contribution to create this wonderful generation. A young man, like some of you these days who become rich very fast, got very rich very fast and became very rich than his father. And he had a bigger house than his father. He bought a bigger car than his father. He bought a bigger piece of land than his father. He put in many cows, more than his father's, and then boasted to his father. And he said, I beat you almost in everything. He had even produced some children. His father had produced a few of them. He had a bigger number now. Now, then when he said, I beat you in everything, his father looked at him and laughed. And said, young man, have you finished of the things you beat me at? The man said, yeah, those are enough. So the father said, you don't have a son like you. Have you had a knockout? That was, he had not produced a son as important as. So, if we haven't done much, if you think you are more important, you have not yet produced a new generation like you. You are our young generation we are proud of. And we did whatever we did for your sake and for our own happiness. And this is what we are sharing. And I want to continue sharing with you. Don't intimidate us. You will be in trouble. In the 6th Parliament, they started, I have been in Parliament for the last 34 years. Almost 34 years now. I have been seeing people coming, going, coming. Now, in the 6th Parliament, the young parliamentarians formed an association. The young, they came. They were there, the Kazora, Buntu, Matembe, the Honorable Saram Musumba. And then they were saying that you old people, this is our time, this is our generation, who want to take charge, you dead wood. I said, what? Dead wood? Said, you young people, come. I invited them in the lobby in our dining, in our canteen. And I told them, be very careful. We are very dangerous. We know what we are doing. We are experienced. We are tested. We are entrenched in our positions. We are even richer than you. If you try to threaten us, you will be in danger. Because we can defend our positions better than you. You are going where we are coming from. We have been there where you are. The best you can do, and I'm now telling you, befriend them. You befriend us. When you befriend us, when you join us, we will be able to pass on our experience. We will be able to show you the bad and the good, the difficult and the which we have gone through. We'll be able to share with you more knowledge. We'll share with you resources. We will trust you and you will trust us. Then we'll be free and happy to pass on the leadership to you for all of us to enjoy. But the moment you threaten us, we can be very, very dangerous. We can hold our ground and keep you out. I want you to do research of the total number of the young parliamentarians. How many are still in parliament? Do research. Most of them became my friends and became very useful. Those who were really violent and who you need to trace where they are. It's how the society works. Nature's design. I talk about design with passion because everything depends on the design. Every living thing has its design. See a tree. Society is like a tree. When you see the beautiful flowers and the very attractive fruits, like I see you here, of any tree, those flowers, those fruits that are very attractive, those green leaves that make the tree look that beautiful are seasonal. Can I repeat? Are what? Where the fruits drop and they are eaten by animals. The leaves, when the weather changes, drop. The smaller stems remain bare. They are all dependent on what is the most important of the tree. It is what you don't see. Our dead comrades who sacrificed, who are not seen, underground. Those roots that go deep where there are stones, where there are difficulties, where they are, they have seen it, they have had all the rough times, are the ones which keep feeding the tree. The season can change, but as long as the roots are firm, and I want to assure you, Uganda's foundation is firm. You enjoy the leaves. You are now reached a stage when you are now the smaller stems. How many of you have started producing children? Those beautiful young children, the grandchildren for us. I love the grandchildren more than even my children now. Because they are more attractive, they are more innocent, they are beautiful. Please, life is designed that the old help the young to grow. Once there is a conflict between the leaves and the root, the institute well organized, but we shall organize.